It's my great pleasure to welcome you to newest in a long series of little conferences, which the journal Boundary 2 has organized here in Pittsburgh, I think now for 20 years, around the event of our annual editorial board meeting on this campus. Often in the past, the papers which we have presented have represented almost the miscellany of work in progress produced by people associated with the journal who have been themselves, still remain for the most part, cutting edge figures in a variety of disciplines and sub-disciplines in the humanities. At times we've organized these mini conferences around particular topics and titles. This year we are presenting our work under the general rubric of poetry and poetics, and in so doing we are building upon a series of events, the first of which occurred at Dartmouth College about 15 months ago, the second of which occurred at UCLA in the spring, this one here today, and then the fourth and final one will return us to Dartmouth College on this topic in the spring of 2015. It's my great pleasure to be able to launch this afternoon and tomorrow's event by introducing to you Professor Donald Pease. Donald Pease is professor of English and comparative literature at Dartmouth College, where he is the Ted and Helen Geisel Third Century Professor in Humanities and chair of the Master of Arts and Liberal Studies program. His topic, titled today, is Whitman's Leaves and Embers. Don and I began our academic careers more or less at the same challenged Jesuit institution of higher learning in Philadelphia, years before the invention of the internet. And after a long period of time of not seeing each other, thanks to a remarkable moment of serendipity when Jonathan Arak returned to the campus of Union Theological Seminary, Columbia, New York, for a conference, another conference of Boundary 2, which was organized by Cornell West. And he brought with him a powerfully intellectual figure dressed in black leather and chains, whom I recognized immediately as my long-lost Jesuit comrade, Donald Pease. And I reacquired that day a traditional role of translator, and I helped to render Cornell West's Schleiermachian discourse into Don's Kierkegaardian discourse, and as we Jesuits used to say, vice versa. And from that moment to this, the grouping has not fallen apart, a fact of which I'm very proud and happy. Don has won practically every important prize that the American Academy offers, some outside the Academy. In 2011, for example, he was given an honorary degree at Uppsala University. In 2012, and I think rather belatedly, the American Studies Association awarded him its Bodie Pearson Prize for lifelong service in American Studies, which, for those of you who don't know, includes very generous service to the association itself. It's a claim that rests, among other things, on his founding editing of the New Americanist series at Duke University Press, which has remade American Studies since the 1980s. And it also includes his role as founding director of the Futures of American Studies Institute at Dartmouth College, which I think has been running now since 1996, and where several current and former doctoral students of this English department have studied on their way to doing distinguished dissertations in American literature. Don is the author or editor of over a dozen books, including his monumental 1987 book, Visionary Compacts, which revised the history of the American national tradition away from the models established both by Matheson and Berkovich, and which also won the Ingram Prize for the best book in the humanities, published in that year. Pease has published more, and for the group of people who are speaking here this weekend, this is going to be now a commonplace, if you can imagine this for any group. Pease has also published more than 100 refereed articles in major journals. He's been a visiting professor everywhere, Columbia University, Indiana University, Wesleyan University, Oxford University as the Drew Hines Professor of American Literature, the University of Rome, the Free University of Berlin, etc., etc. He's lectured at all of the rest of the world's major universities on most continents, I think not yet in Antarctica, and he's currently completing two new books, American Studies After the New Americanists and Globalizing the American Renaissance. Don joined the editorial collective of Boundary 2, I believe in 1981, and has edited two special issues of the journal. In 2011, he was distinguished visiting scholar at the Humanities Center here at Pitt, and I think it is likely that Don Pease has spoken more often at this university since the early 1990s than he has anywhere else but Dartmouth. And I think we owe him a special debt of gratitude, special sign of recognition for his generosity in visiting this campus and helping us all keep a strong place on the map of American studies. So please welcome Don Pease.
Incredibly generous and very moving introduction. This talk is more a work in progress and perhaps closer to a miscellany than a finished work, so I'm looking forward to the conversation that'll follow from it. In it, I'm trying to figure something out about Walt Whitman's and poetry and the way to inherit it. The title of my talk is Whitman's Poetics, Leaves and Embers. I'll situate these figures within a scene from Whitman's Song of Myself, in which three of Whitman's primary poetic tropes, leaves of grass sprouting up across a field, the open air, man on moss, turn into ashes and embers in a moment. Before doing so, however, I want to turn to a scene from Michael Cunningham's remarkable novel, Specimen Days, that inherits what Whitman has elided from that scene. That scene that concludes with, "Then commenced the burning of the bodies." At his most effusive, Whitman cast his poetry as a compendium in which readers could encounter the most vital sources of life. I celebrate myself and sing myself, and what I assume you shall assume, for every atom belonging to me as good belongs to you. These opening lines of Song of Myself feature the singular compact made available by the singer who writes them down. The phrase, "and what I assume, you shall assume," calls attention to the transtemporal and transspatial mobility of the I, who will have been read by a you. When this speaking I's atoms have disintegrated from the body that assumed them, the you's act of reading will have become the means of celebrating this ongoing participation in unbound atoms becoming compact human forms of life across time and space. In addressing a you who shall assume a form of life out of a gathering of atoms that the singing self now celebrates, the written I becomes myself song once again through the reader's gathering of atoms into the shape of a human form of life. Reading these lines as a shared celebration of the pluriform life of life. Now consider what happens to I and you in the following passage. What do you think has become of the young and the old men? And what do you think has become of the women and children? They are alive and well somewhere. the smallest sprout shows here is really no death. And if ever there was, it led forward life and does not wait at the end to arrest it and cease the moment life appeared. All goes onward and outward, nothing collapses. And to die is different from what anyone supposes, and luckier. The shifter I and the deictics here and now, as well as the implied you in the enunciating subjects, I am here now saying this to you. All of these lack objective definition. As Mitchell Breitweiser first observed, they depend on the reader's colloquial participation in an instance of discourse that solicits our inclusion as interlocutors involved in the semblance of a conversation. Without this pretense of a you addressed within an ostensibly shared time and place, the sense of such lines would be utterly lost. Spoken deixis implies at least two people who are both compact and visible at the same time and place, as Breitweiser further explains this transaction. Written deixis calls attention to the fact that either the writer or the reader is discernibly compact or visible, but not both. When we encounter the I in writing undefined by clear, spatial, temporal, biographical supplements, we encounter the self-designation of a dead man with whom we continue to communicate by assuming one of the infinite forms of life Whitman's poetry concelebrates. Whitman's poetic compact presupposed the virtuality of this shared space of colloquy between reader and himself. But the reader Whitman addresses as you almost never cohabits the place and time of the poet doing the addressing. Indeed, Whitman rarely, almost never, represented himself in a face-to-face meeting with a contemporary. But Lucas, the 12-year-old boy in the opening novella of Michael Cunningham's Specimen Days, who reads Whitman's Leaves of Grass every night and considers it the book of life, quite literally bumps into Whitman on the Broadway of post-Civil War Manhattan. In the following passage, Cunningham represents Lucas as a reader who wants answers from his poet maestro in the here and now. What Lucas wanted from Whitman, Cunningham writes, was the raucousness of the city, where people hauled their loads of corn or coal, where they danced the fiddles, wept or laughed, sold and begged and bartered, not always happily, but always with a vigor. That was what he meant privately by soul. It was a defiant, uncrushable aliveness. He hoped to understand through Whitman an aliveness he doesn't deeply feel. Lucas spouts passages from Leaves of Grass as a kind of Tourette syndrome throughout the novel without knowing what he's saying, but sensing that whatever it is in these lines he is saying is the undefinable, essential something that's not in him. In the following passage, Cunningham has Whitman respond to Lucas's question as if it were one to which Whitman's poetry can provide a direct answer. Lucas gathered himself, all of his atoms now, have become a compact form speaking to the poet. He said, I wonder if I might ask you a question, sir. Sir, do the dead return in the grass? They do, my boy, Whitman replies. They are in the grass and in the trees. Only there? No, not only there. They are in the air and the water. They are in the earth and the sky. They are in our minds and hearts. And in the machines, Lucas wants to know, Well, yes, they're the machines. They are everywhere. So Lucas had been right. If he harbored doubts about the machines, here was the answer. The dead in the machines to which Lucas refers include his deceased older brother, Simon, who was literally devoured by a pressing machine. Lucas, who has taken his dead brother's place in the impressment factory called the Works, fears his brother's specter now wants him. It was what the book told him night after night. When he died, he would leave his defective body and turn into grass. He would be like this forever. There was not reason to fear it, because it was part of it. What he thought of sometimes as his absence of soul was only a yearning for this. The industrial fires that provide the heat and energy for the impressment factory at novel's end gather into a terrible conflagration. In watching it envelop a series of factory workers, Lucas recognizes fire as the most efficient medium for transfiguring the dead. And in this passage, he literally turns himself into an ember ignited by Whitman's poetry to receive the fire. The dead had entered the atmosphere. Lucas knew it. With every breath, Lucas took the dead inside it. This was their bitter taste. This was how they lay, ashen and hot, on the tongue. An ember floated by, brilliantly orange like the little lights in the curtain of pain, but far brighter. He paused. He couldn't help pausing to watch the ember drift past. He felt himself seen by a presence that knew him beyond his name or person, beyond the mechanism of flesh and bone that slept in a room. The ember said, "Every atom belonging to me, as good, belongs to you." In response, Lucas's heart raged and burned, full of its own fire. God is a holy machine that loves us so fiercely, so perfectly. He devours us, all of us. He now knew that he was one of the dead, and always had been. He felt his heart burst like a peach breaking through the skin. He wanted to say, "I am large, I contain multitudes. I am the grass under your feet. What I assume, you shall assume." But there is nothing measured about the ashes Lucas breathes or the ember that ignites his witness. Their proclivity to scatter precluded the possibility of being gathered into a compact shape that would turn "what I assume, you shall assume" into any form of life other than that of Lucas's scattering of these ashes and embers. The remainder of this afternoon's talk, I want to continue deliberating over a scene from Walt Whitman's Song of Myself, in which the speaker's recollection of a scene of colonial violence coincided with the discovery of resources within his poetic personality that Whitman called the me, myself. Until Cunningham's specimen days, what took place on this scene was unclaimed by Whitman's interpreter and unclaimable by the poet. This talk will turn on the proposition that this disavowed underside of the primal scene of Whitman's poetry figured as the site of enunciation for the speech acts whereby Walt Whitman celebrated the United States itself as the greatest poem. And the primal scene of Whitman's communication, of Whitman's poetics, is a scene that you could have imagined Lucas wanting to have heard. I mind how once we lay such a transparent summer morning, how you settled your head athwart my hips and gently turned over upon me, and parted the shirt from my bosom bone, and plunged your tongue to my bare heart, and reached till you felt my beard, and reached till you held my feet. Swiftly arose and spread around me the peace and knowledge that pass all the art and argument of the earth. And I know that the hand of God is the promise of my own. And I know that the spirit of God is the brother of my own. And that all the men ever born are also my brothers. And the women my sisters and lovers. And that a kelson of the creation is love. And limitless are leaves stiff or drooping in the fields, and brown ants in the little wells beneath them, and mossy scabs in the worm fence, heaped stones, elder, mullein, and pokeweed. You imagine the heart that's bursting just before Lucas dies, now touched by the tongue of fire of the poet, who is literally turning him back into the leaves of grass. You'll see that's the primal scene of communication in Whitman's Poetics, as usually understood. I will specifically focus on the section in Song of Myself in which Whitman imagines himself as a poetic witness to a death camp, so that he might imagine his song as the constituent power that materialized the life that passed through it. I shall discuss Whitman's vexed relationship to the battle at Goliad in greater detail when I turn to his account of the events that took place there in Song of Myself shortly. Just now, I need to provide a schematic account of the incident. The Battle of Goliad was part of the Texas Revolution that culminated in the independence of Texas in April of 1836. Goliad marked the conclusion to a much larger battle that took place in Goleta, Texas, March 19th to 20, 1836. On March 27, 1836, 354 American prisoners from the battle were executed under the command of General Santa Anna. The difference between the mass deaths at Alamo and Goliad was that the soldiers who died at Goliad had signed a treaty of surrender. Those who died at Alamo did not. In several accounts of the Battle of Goliad, Whitman published while working as a journalist, specifically an editorialist for the Brooklyn Eagle. He turned Goliad into a synecdoche for the state of Mexico that Whitman enclosed within the nomos of a camp. Goliad named a space of generalized violence that Whitman included within the territorial United States to delineate what its civil order must exclude so as to render discernible an ineradicable difference from the state of Mexico that Whitman characterized as non-civilizable. This is his editorial of May 5th, 1846. We have dammed up our memories of what has passed in the South years ago, of the devilish massacres of some of our bravest and noblest sons, the children not of the South alone, but of the North and West, massacres in defiance not only of ordinary humanity, but in violation of all the rules of war. Who has read the sickening story of those brutal wholesale murders so useless for any purpose except gratifying the cowardly appetite of a nation of bravos, willing to shoot down men in the hundreds in cold blood, without panting for the day when the prayer of that blood should be listened to, when the vengeance of a retributive God should be meted out to those who so ruthlessly and needlessly slaughtered his image. Whitman's description of the events at Goliad as the needless slaughter of God's image rendered them sacred. After representing the U.S.-Mexican War as retribution for the sacred martyrs murdered at Goliad, Whitman supplied the U.S. invasion of Mexico with a sanctifying function.
positioning himself as an editorialist at the site of a violation of America's providential history, Whitman reinvested his readers' moral outrage at the young men's deaths into the regenerative violence directed against those who did not deserve to live. Whitman thereafter represented the state's appropriation of Mexican territory during the U.S.-Mexican War as just recompense for the martyrdom sustained by U.S. citizens who occupied it. But something got lost in Whitman's translation of this event from the editorials he published in the Blue Eagle to section 34 of Song of Myself. It begins, "Now I tell what I knew in Texas in my early youth. I tell not the fall of Alamo, not one escaped to tell the fall of Alamo. The 150 are dumb yet at Alamo. 'Tis the tale of the murder in cold blood of 412 young men. Retreating, they had formed in a hollow square with their baggage for breastworks, 900 lives out of the surrounding enemies, nine times their number, was the price they took in advance. Their colonel was wounded, their ammunition gone. They treated for an honorable capitulation, received writing and seal, gave up their arms, and marched back, prisoners of war. They were the glory of the race of rangers, matchless with horse, rifle, song, supper, courtship, large, turbulent, generous, handsome, affectionate, bearded, sunburnt, dressed in the free costume of hunters, not a single one over 30 years of age. The second first day morning, they were brought out in squads and massacred. It was a beautiful early summer. The work commenced about 5 o'clock. And was over by 8. None obeyed the command to kneel. Some made a mad and helpless rush. Some stood stark and straight. A few fell at once, shot in the temple or heart. The living and dead lay together. The maimed and mangled dug in the dirt. The newcomers saw them there. Some half killed attempted to crawl away. These were dispatched with bayonets or battered with the blunts of muskets. A youth, not 17 years old, seized his assassin till two more came to release him. The three were all torn and covered with the boy's blood. Then commenced the burning of the bodies." Now, Whitman does not stay in the scene for the burning of the bodies, as Lucas does in the scene for the catastrophe at Manhattan Factory. But he converts the transition into the recovery of what he calls the spirit of his compact, the spirit of his poetry. But I want to ask is whether the spirit of the poetry has been ignited by the fire. Now, what I find most compelling about Whitman's account of the Battle of Goliad as reference to its placement in the poem, Whitman's retelling of the Battle of Goliad takes place within a series of passages in Song of Myself, wherein Whitman's identification with the bodies of the wounded, the impoverished, the enslaved, ruptured the continuity between the self, body, and nation his song had heretofore achieved. Whitman's most accomplished critics and interpreters have characterized this entire sequence of passages that begins with the assertion, "Agonies are one of my changes of garments," and then concludes with the phrase, "I sit shamefaced and beg," as unassimilable to the logic of celebratory identification underwriting the rest of the poem. Alan Grossman, to name but one of those interpreters, of representatives of the American people in a place that has been torn from the geographical United States. But if the men's deaths in 1836 had already been avenged during the U.S.-Mexican War, why does the speaker even feel obliged to recall the murder of 412 young men now? He does so in part, I would argue, because this scene supplied the transitional object by means of which he separated himself from the perspective of the editorial writer and became the poet of Leaves of Grass. What gets lost in the translation of the story of Goliad from the editorials to the poetry is the frame narrative through which the editor had historicized these events. As we've seen, the editor covered over the hole Goliad had opened up in the symbolic network by placing it in the psychically restorative context of a patriotic revenge narrative. The poet's recollection of the events that had transpired at Goliad is marked by the absence of any stirring rhetoric with which the editor had come to terms with them. In place of the dialectical relationship between violence and retribution, the poet encounters only the fearful contingency at the heart of the event. When the poet returned to this place of memory, he described it as a spot where a glorious race of rangers had lain down in fields of grass that their assassins ignited into fiery graves. Upon re-encountering this site 9 years after the termination of the Mexican-American War, Whitman withdrew the words upon which he had formerly staked his profession as an editor and enjoined his readers to participate in collective witness to this scene of catastrophic loss. Bereft of the triumph narrative through which the editor had represented it, the poet feels obligated to figure out how to navigate this affective terrain without that narrative. The editor of the Brooklyn Eagle could not fathom this act of democide without converting it into the basis for sovereign vengeance. But the poet tarries at the site of this catastrophe to draw in not the resources of nomos, but the resources of anomi, this nothing out of which his poetry will emerge. This event cannot be integrated within the political metaphysics of manifest destiny that underwrote the editorial writer's sense of historical continuity. But if the poet does not wish to reject language or to abandon life, how can he choose words so that others do not despair or become overtaken by grief? What I find most affecting about Whitman's choice of this scene to enact the distinction between his personae as poet and editor specifically pertains to the transformation it affected in his attitude towards language. As we've seen, the mass execution at Goliad resulted from General Santa Anna's suspension of the rules of the treaty that guaranteed the safety of the prisoners under his charge. Giorgio Agamben explains the situation in terms of the paradoxical logic of the exception. Santa Anna's declaration of the state of exception opened up an anomic space in which what was in operation when he ordered his troops to execute their prisoners was a force of law without law. Force of law with law X'd out, in which potentiality and act were radically separated. When application and norm undergo separation within this anomic space, a pure force of law emerges. That is, it applies by ceasing to apply. The state of exception defines a state of law in which, on the one hand, the norm, in this case, adhering to the rules and conditions pertaining to the treatment of prisoners of war, is in force, but it's not applied. It has no force of enforcement. And on the other hand, acts that do not have the value of law, like the mass execution of the men imprisoned at Goliad, acquire the law's force. Desaplicando is the technical term which describes a norm whose application has been suspended. What I find significant for this discussion of the moment at which Whitman underwent a change of vocation from editor to poet refers to the significance Agamben assigns disapplicando to the understanding of the enunciative function. Just as between language and world, so between norm and application, there is no internal nexus that allows one to be derived immediately from the other. The task of wedding norm and reality together, and thereby constituting the normal sphere, is carried out in the form of an exception. That is to say, by presupposing that their nexus already exists. Construed from the standpoint of language practices, the state of exception refers to an anomic space in which the potentiality of expressive communication is separated from the communicative act, or that which empowers speech to become meaningful for another speaker. In such cases, the state of exception marks a threshold at which logic and praxis blur into each other. And a pure violence without logos claims to realize an enunciation without any real reference. Whitman has entered the place of the chaos of the anomie precipitated by the broken treaty to take up the pure violence as the poesis that took the place of the force of law that suspended the conditions of the treaty. Because the already constituted forms established by the treaty lacked the force of law capable of ensuring the men's survival, the poet's speech acts alone were capable of investing them with linguistic viability. It was their violent severance of the Texans from the already constituted terms and rules of the treaty that placed them in need of the constituent power that only the poet could supply. Now, constituent power is going to be a key term in the rest, because constituent power literally means a power that emerges out of nothing. It doesn't refer to an already constituted power, and it doesn't refer to a constituting power that would presuppose an already existing constitution. It's pure violence operating as language. What I'm going to wonder about, so that you get the direction of the thought, is whether constituent power and Whitman's poesis participates in the fire of the sovereign that brought about the conflagration of the men. Is Whitman's poetry a continuation of the sovereign violence that apparently displaces? Or is it another form of life altogether? The poet acquired this constituent power by re-entering the space of extreme anomie, where the force of law has separated from its forms. In this space, Whitman took up the place of the witness to the terms and conditions of violated compact that would have guaranteed the men's continued viability as prisoners of war. As the witness to the nexus that should have rendered the rules and terms of the treaty binding, the poet impersonated the tie, the uptake of the enunciative function that would have linked the Texan's constituted forms to the constituting words. His speech act draws upon this secondary constituent power of poesis to bind the Texan forms to the poem through which they remain memorable. But how does his poesis differ from the violence of the fire? In this dark passage, Song of Myself came to a virtual standstill, the poetic equivalent of a solstice. On this scorched earth, this potter's field of the uncelebrated dead, bereft of any grass, the sun itself seemed to have stood still. The editor of the Brooklyn Eagle could not fathom this act, as I've mentioned, without converting it into an incitement for political action. The editorials sacralized the trauma as a catastrophic revelation that has enabled the editorialist to come face to face with the image of God. This frame of reference forecloses the problem the event posed for the conditions of representation with a redemptive sublation. But this event can neither be integrated within the political metaphysics of manifest destiny nor the national narrative it underwrites. The event's traumatizing affects open up a disjunction between sight and knowledge, between seeing and being overtaken by the memories of the unseen, the uncelebrated dead. In this passage, Whitman has taken the power of naming away from a politics pursued as a national religion. In the poetry, we obtain access to a region beyond the pleasure principle. Whitman's poetry cannot endow the catastrophe that has gathered Whitman's primary poetic tropes, leaves of grass spouting up across a field, the open air, which has now become all smoke, man en masse within its conflagration. In any form, other than the registering of an eventfulness that never ceases coming to pass. The dehistoricization of the event sets its elements empirically adrift, turning this dissociated memory into a catch-all for all the memories that the poet does not wish to claim. In the place of the missing frame, the poet has added the arresting image of the boy grappling with his assassin as the affective nexus binding him to the event, with the result that the event appears like a never-ending image. It is always on the verge of becoming again. If you can reimagine that boy that he has imagined as the figure lying on a field of grass with his heart now bare-stripped, he's been bayoneted, and Whitman turning to the dead boy on the field of Goliath with a tongue of fire that would literally restore him to the grass and produce the peace in the sight of war that would surpass all the art and argument of the earth. You'll see how Whitman's primal scene of poetic communication is in this scene that is enveloping it with fire. His efficacy as the event's witness is dependent upon his own exposure to annihilation in the scene that has just taken possession of him. Poised in the anguish of being witness to the event of mass murder and a collective conflagration, the poet engages his readers in his effort to pass this experience on. The poet would appear to have been seized by the deep unconscious involuntary memory that lies outside of history understood as a consciously remembered experience. The tempo of this pent-up memory breaks into historical time. It is now lacking a cohesive narrative in which to historically situate the event. The phrase, "now I tell," positions the speaker in a time that is exterior to the time in which these events happened and deprives chronological time and geographical space of their powers of compulsion. This phrase suspends the reader's attention within an assemblage of unassimilable time that generates an alternative sense of space. Whitman's recovery of this traumatizing memory takes place within a site that is dissevered from the nation that would include it within its geography. This site emerges from a past that is no longer directly accessible as a cultural survivor that points to a future. In witnessing this event through a subjective lens, Whitman finds words that enable him to achieve a fragile, apparent mastery over the immobilizing fascination of the spectacle through the devising of an apparent response. In doing so, he endows the scene with an afterlife or an after effect. It lives on because Whitman has supplied it with a narrative of transmission. He has ignited it. As he passes on their story, the poet inhabits an affective site informed by the terrible anxiety of the men's response to extreme danger. The men, whose collective fate the poet memorializes, appear to be in close enough psychological proximity to the poet to be all but looking at him. And they're demanding that he sing their song as the implicit promise of renegotiating the relationship between the living and the dead. The voices of these dead men cry out for the entreaty of the poetry as compensation for the violation of their treaty of surrender, the impossible demand to sing them a new song discloses that his poetry originates from outside the social world, consisting of acts of recognition by which you and I might know one another. Insofar as it gives expression to the breach in the relationship between the enunciated and the enunciating forms of the treaty, the phrase, "Now I tell," involves the poet in a tacit dialogue that brings his readers into a zone of a catastrophically broken discourse. Because the horrifying singularity of the fact that it happened can no longer be claimed by a narrative to which to make sense of it, the poet draws the reader into the perspective in which the event recurs, but without any explanatory logic of a historically referential past. The traumatizing effects of the violated compact oblige the reader who bears its witness, the writer who bears it witness, to convey it to a reader. But the dialogical relationship between poet and reader partakes of the traumatizing eventfulness that threatens to embed even the dialogic relation between speaker and listener within its orbit. In lacking anchorage within history's real, this event is inscribed in the now of a poetic enunciation that cannot be received in any form other than the traumatic event. This traumatic memory that has broken into the present lives on in the empty materiality of poetry, where it survives in a form that is otherwise than historic, inscribed as a painful happening whose cause is suppressed in favor of its continuing effects. The poem does not lift this event from a recognizable past. It instead discloses the intensity of the object loss of its history. Now, this is part of a much longer explanation, and I'm going to abbreviate it by going to Whitman's attempt to exit from this scene. He exits before he witnesses the burning of the bodies. He said, "Then commenced the burning of the bodies." And what takes the place of the witness that Lucas experienced, breathing in the dead, is enough, enough. It's a password, turning all the command words of the treaty into the sheer power of a password that unbinds linguistic energies altogether and enables a sheer passage. Enough, enough, enough. Somehow I have been stunned. Stand back. Give me a little time. Beyond my cuffed head, slumbers, dreams, gapings, I discover myself on the verge of a usual mistake, that I could forget the mockers and insults, that I could forget the trickling tears and the blows of bludgeons and hammers, that I could look with a separate look on my own crucifixion and bloody crown. I remember now. I resume the overstayed fraction. The grave of rock multiplies what has been confided to it or to any graves. Corpses rise, gashes heal, fastenings roll from me. I troop forth replenished with supreme power, one of an average unending procession. Inland and seacoast we go and pass all boundary lines. Our swift ordinances on their way over the whole earth. The blossoms we wear in our hats, the growth of thousands of years. Eleves, I salute you. Come forward, continue your annotations, continue your questionings. The composer of these lines is eager to renew the poetic compact for which the previous scene performed a radical breach. He has reluctantly come to this narration of the earth itself in a crisis of foliation, where men are mowed down like grass, gathered and ignited en masse, leaving ashes and embers. Whitman presents the scene as a moment of danger, suspended within an interval that he's already surpassed. Fixing the scene within this threshold of a fraction, he need exit rather than overstay, becomes part of the work of deleting it. The speaker does not know what to make of what happens here, other than an exit from it. The speaker's need to restrict its eventfulness to the serial that, which will annul repetition, which will annul the scene's repetition, betrays the desperation inhabiting that impossibility. That's eventfulness overwhelms the here now of the speaker's performative placement and threatens to reignite through all the passages preceding and to come. Can the fire which commence spread? Does that scene's after image inhabit all the other passages, like the after effect of an ember? Is Whitman's passion to get out of the scene already taken up, ignited by the ember? Does this radical discontinuation, this break, underrate all the other passages in Whitman's song? Isn't it too late to speak of resuming the overstayed fraction after the victims have been reduced to ash in the blaze of the glory of the race of rangers? There is no justice for the men en masse whose bodies became fuel for the pyre in this pyro-political moment of constituent power. Once fire engulfs them, they achieve equality through their translation into ashes left over after the great fire. Cinders and ashes, as Derrida has reminded us, are not absolutely nothing, but they are nothing that can be grasped in an ontophenomenological sense as a world constructed in the structures of meaning, humanity. Ashes are meaningless within the everyday matrix of sense, unpresentable, unrepresentable in the bright light of Whitman's life-giving eye. Ashes' significance inheres in their absolute withdrawal from the realm of phenomenality. The transition in Whitman's poetry from editorialist to poet takes place precisely at the moment when the distances between the seer and the scene and the animated vision between them collapses. That is to say, when the fire burns in the witness to the conflagration. How can you bear witness to the conflagration without yourself becoming an ember? The spectacle of the defeated dragged into the sphere of phenomenality is the ultimate historical violence of their afterlife in and out of ashes. But for Michael Cunningham, the catastrophe already will have occurred in the very poetic legacy of Walt Whitman, who would have deleted it. And that Michael Cunningham has inherited in specimen days through the witness of Lucas. And that's it.
We have.
Yeah, come in.
All right, this might seem. It's not. It's ridiculous to ask a question after such a beautiful talk. However, I was thinking about something. When we look at September 11th, and we look at those buildings down, and we look at those flames, and we look at those dead bodies, and we look at the ashes, all the elements that you're talking about here. But the difference is that after that, we did not find in us Whitman's ability to turn to let the embers inflame him. We instead engaged in militaristic bombing. So Condé Rice says there was no way we could connect the dots. Whitman might have said, I can connect the dots. We could connect the dots. Is that?
Well, what I'm trying to call attention to is Michael Cunningham wrote Specimen Days after 9/11, and you cannot not see that the entirety of Specimen Days is about the way in which Whitman was himself, Whitman's poetry was invoked after 9/11 by President Bush to solidify a certain conservative understanding of a multicultural democracy. Whitman's poetry was invoked by other figures in order to present precisely the very contrary that your question reactivates, reperforms. But Cunningham is asking this question. Has the very witness of Whitman's poetry that emerged at the site of what he experienced as the possible complete conflagration of the world in which he lived and believed by impending war, be understood to be completely separated, separable from the violence he would delete. The Cunningham is suggesting that the figure of the witness to sovereign violence, even when that witness is invoking the pure violence and pure performativity of poesis as such, is nonetheless participating in the violence of the sovereign fire. And that's why he has taken a figure, Walt Whitman, who tells us there is no death, and disclosed what constitutes the deep paradox of that particular claim. If you claim that your poetry stands between the thought of death and the knowledge of death, and produces a vitalizing current by transposing death itself into a form in which the relay of the circle of life will continue to animate to eternity. You have produced by your poetry no resource that will enable you to occupy any particular socially mandated function other than the sense that when I die, I will pass into the grass or the trees. What Cunningham is calling attention to is that the very ecstatic affirmation of Whitman's witness is itself a form of social death, insofar as it acknowledges no historically mandated position a self can occupy, other than participating in the I sing myself and celebrate myself, and what I assume you shall assume. For every atom belonging to me, his good belongs to you. But what if the biofuels that inhabited the factories during the post-Civil War Industrial Revolution are what is passing through life as its means of transmission? Will the atoms of bodies converted to ashes gather back into integrated forms of life? Can the dust speak? That's what Cunningham is asking, I think, by returning to Whitman at this moment.
I too feel that to join with the question, the profound re-inhabitation of Whitman's poem that you've offered is a very hard thing to do. I will propose, in a ridiculous schematism, that you've set up a space where Whitman's this compost is on one side, and the judge from Blood Meridian on the other. And if you feel like engaging that, that would be interesting. But I want to go back.
Don't tempt me.
I want to go back to around minute 35 as you moved
what
from.
What time is it?
Plenty of time, Doc.
As you moved
you
from.
You were counting my hours. What will this end?
Well, I didn't want to write it.
What will the fire be?
As you more or less concluded the movement of transformation from editorialist to poet, the separation from the nation, I believe, was the term you used, although you may remember better than I know. And that was immediately followed by the evocation of beyond the pleasure principle. Yeah. And it's the relation between those two forms of either transcendence or transgression that I think it would be helpful to spell out a little more if you'd like.
Okay, the logic of the revenge principle is a sacrificial logic in which life substitutes for the loss of life. And you sustain the order that is by way of sustaining that sacrificial logic. And in not to produce a spoiler for those of you who haven't yet read Cunningham's remarkable work, Lucas understands that the only way in which he can truly mourn his dead brother is by quite literally taking up his place in the works and feeling himself inhabited by the same desires as his dead brother, as a literalization of the sacrificial logic of revenge. Whitman wants to completely suspend the sacrificial logic by adding what he considers to be the love compact at the site of the revenge. When he, instead of reanimating the logic of the editorialist's revenge, turns from retrieving the sanctity of the image of God by turning to the image of the boy being bayoneted with his stripped heart by an assassin. And as the poet, he's literally moving into the place where the assassin opened up his heart. And instead of taking revenge, he's placing his tongue, that is his utterance, in the boy's open heart, so that in place of the need for the revenge, there will be the love, the peace. He has, what he has done is he has suspended the desire for revenge with love, as it is manifest in his poesis. What I'm asking, and this is, you know, on the one hand, this is also, as you know, for me, a very difficult question to ask of a poet who has been, for me, an incredible source of life and inspiration all my life. So I'm asking of that moment, in the poem, whether that drive beyond the pleasure principle, that drive of love, he's driven to love, is separable from the violence inhabiting the sacrificial logic of the revenge. Whitman does not enter, this is why he never produces a face-to-face encounter in his poetry. This is why Cunningham demands that he have a face-to-face encounter with a boy who's asking him, what is my socially mandated position in a historically ordered world? Who am I? What am I to be? Whitman did not produce a logic of socially mandated positions because he understood them as sacrificial. He understood the historical logic of socialization as such to be a sacrificial logic of substituting the living for the dead. And in place of that, he produced a capacity to take the greatest fear that underwrites the logic of sacrifice, the thought of death, the knowledge of death, and to turn that into an outlet song. He calls it death's outlet song. Decease calls me forth, he writes. So that in the place where the dead would otherwise be substituted by the living, he produces in that space a form of love that can never be disappointed by its finding a specific lover. But it's love, passing through everything. Insofar as the love cannot find and cannot eventuate in a relation with a beloved that is other than inclusive of everything, every form of life through which life passes. Whitman's love, I'm suggesting in that particular formulation, is inseparable from a death drive, from the death drive. It is the drive of death impersonating life as love.
Don, this might be related to the question that Jonathan just asked. I can't get over the eroticism of the plunging tongue.
Okay.
Right?
No, I can't.
So, I mean, you know, it's like Clinton Thompson getting stuck at that door back there in Absalom. I get stuck at that place. Do you want to say more about that?
Yeah. When Whitman, first of all, the figure of the speaking self, which appears to be alive, or you, most people associate with Whitman, the figure speaking, is the figure whose heart has been bare stripped. That is, the figure speaking is the figure whose heart has been completely opened. It is open to its own death. The heart is the heart of a dying man. When he imagines the you turning over on the bare-stripped heart and plunging the tongue into the heart, that act, and that's the moment in which he's also uttering the hum of the velvet voice. He's, by way of that poetic communication, producing the means whereby that dying heart passes through all forms of life. As the love and peace that surpasseth the art and argument of the earth. He's imagining, let's make it graphic. At the sight in which you could lose the being with whom you are most passionately in love to death. At the moment of that separation, that complete separation between the living and the dead, you place your most life-giving part into the place of the dying self. Then you have, by way of bringing life into the moment in which there is a passage from life into death, the means whereby death and life communicate as love in a peace that surpasseth understanding. It is absolute eros, indistinguishable from absolute thanatos. It is where life death and love death. I am in love in the moment of the dying beloved with the dead, through the beloved, which passeth through all forms of life. That's the primal, I think, scene of Whitman's poetic communication. And he produces that moment, I'm going to argue, prior to the burning of the boy's body. But the boy's body has not passed into the ground to become elder and mullein reed. It has passed into the flames. And that's what Whitman has separated from. But is the fire of passion that enters the spermaticon of the husk, the heart is the, I mean, he's also going through an Eleusinian vegetation mystery in which he's literally inhabiting the husk of the source of all grass, the source of wheat, the source of all vegetation. He's inhabiting it at the moment in which that husk will pass into the ground and become the basis for the sprouting up across the field. But at that moment of the Eleusinian, at that moment of the mystery, the body's taken and burned. And what I want to ask is whether the fire in the heart. Hart Crane goes to this passage in Cape Hatteras in order to get to the Gould Mount. And he has Whitman taken by hand. Panis Angelicus, he calls it. Take me by hand to pass through this. But what I want to ask is whether at that moment in the poem, which is an anticipation of the then commenced the burning of the bodies, the fire in the heart the fire in the tongue of fire, has itself participated in the flames, in the power of the flames, in the constituent power of the flames. That's the question I want to ask. Yes?
Well, maybe you could entertain or wonder about maybe there's a possibility that you're talking about his poetry and the fire and his poetry and the sovereign power of the state, but maybe Whitman is trying to articulate a kind of a covert rhetoric of solidarity or something, and the only option he has is kind of negative image of the state. So if you think about like the uniform hieroglyphic in that passage, with the what is the grass section, and then like what is growing from the tongues of the dead, the grass is growing from the tongues of the dead. So maybe, I don't know, to entertain the idea that maybe it is not so much that in that passage you read from the Cunningham that we could see Whitman as just as much the fire as that we could see the fire in Whitman. I mean, it was kind of at the time, state violence was the kind of crucible for his poetics, and so he wasn't necessarily able to clearly articulate another vision so much as to kind of open up the possibility that there was something there that had not yet been articulated.
No, I agree with that. I think that's a true observation. And let me flesh it out, because at the time he's writing this in 55, there's a possibility that there will be not one state form of violence, but a whole sectional iteration of states in violence. And he does not want to identify, he does not identify with any faction in the poetry. He does not produce solidarity with any specific faction. Because for Whitman to identify with any faction is to sustain the logic of the broken compact and the sovereign violence that enforces it. So Whitman instead produces a poetic instrument that will pass through, and this is where I'm agreeing with what you're saying, will pass through all forms of sovereign state violence and all forms of opposition to sovereign state violence as that which sustains their communication with one another. Because when Whitman can imagine himself not as a particular embodied self, but as the most primal mode of communication between persons, the I-you, in which I speaking to you have to experience you as more internal to the I as I respond to you than the I formerly was. He produces in his speech act a sense of interlocution of the inter-subject. He's not a subject speaking to another, he's the movement of intersubjectivity without subjectivization, if I can put it that way. He would cure the sectional violence that colloquy or conversation has fallen into by restoring to both of the adversaries in the conversation the feeling of being celebrated equally by the poet, who is not so much identified with either of the factional figures, but is instead the whole means of loving agreement that is latent beneath the apparent factional disagree. Whitman imagines himself in even the moment of deepest hatred as that which is trying to express its deepest passional hatred. He loved to go into a bar and just sit between people who were really arguing with one another. And imagine what would that happen with a few drinks and before the what really arguing. And he'd just sit between them. He'd sit between them and feel himself as if he were the electric current of love underneath all of their apparent hostility. And so he's a form of solidarity that paradoxically is universalized rather than restricted. Put it differently, let's say he's the general economy of solidarity rather than a restricted form of solidarity.
So with his poetry, is it the unacknowledged legislator?
I would not embrace the Shelleyan thing, because the unacknowledged legislator for as the poet for Shelley is the figure who really produces the tacit fantasy that law has to presuppose. But Whitman didn't want to have anything to do with law. He was love before law. That is, which law always already has displaced, but can't be displaced. Bruce.
Pardon me if I missed something here, but it sounds to me, I'm thinking of your answer to the question before, like, ideally, in order for that vision to be realized, there ought to be some fairly concrete expression of sympathy for, let's say, Mexican victims of American bombs. Is there such a thing in there?
No, and that's also why I have suggested. You know, in the longer version of this, I suggest that if we're to imagine a historical locus for Whitman's singing, I celebrate myself and sing myself, and what I assume you shall assume, you have to imagine the mortalized body of Mexico as the site in which he's performing his song. There's a deep, deep blindness at the heart of his love. And it is only partially displaced when he takes the place of the Mexican assassin as the site of the poet's witness. But the Mexicans remain the assassins.
I've been thinking about how this is such an incredible reinvention of yours, in the way that Whitman is usually understood, thinking about that haunting section, of course, with the villainous touch.
Yes.
And all that's been made of the me, myself, at the headland.
Yeah.
I mean, this takes it out of the question of personal identity and the me, myself.
Yes. Yeah.
And that whole autoeroticism that Harold Bloom had such fun with.
Yeah.
Can you say a little bit about that touch?
Colin is referring to a moment in which he feels sexual urge. And he feels sexual urge, and he describes it as that which is lapping at him, as fire. He says, it's lapping at me, like fiery tongues. And because I think your question was really resonating with what Hortense was asking about Eros. His erotic drive is a fire. It is indissociable from fire. And the fire, I'm suggesting, is the witness, the ember witnessing
the violation of the compact to produce the poesis that will transpose the logics of the sovereign compact.
And it is sexual. It is ignited the way sexual passion is ignited.
But most people, I mean, in the old days, his poesis was found in his own touch of himself, and that whole passage where, you know, voice is equated with that ejaculatory sequence. Now, once you start thinking through what you've been telling us, it becomes a whole other register of selfhood, which is quite remarkable. Thinking of the sections 27.
It is a completely different register of selfhood. And it's a completely different register of selfhood from the usual understanding of Whitman as the universal receptacle of self who receives all of the living and the dead and gives back bountiful resource. I'm suggesting that the bountiful resource is indistinguishable from the nothing of fire.
And the remnant, the ember.
And the ember, yes.
And the free and friendly savage.
Yes.
Uh,